Afternoon. All right, there's a handout coming around. That handout is your homework that's due next time, a week from today, because it's not in the app, it's in the sheet. And we're actually going to work one of the problems today, so I'm going to do part of your homework for you today. Excuse me. Well, a couple announcements. We've got a couple things coming up. There is an exam on 11/23. It's on a Monday. And it's 6 to 8 p.m. It is not a Wednesday, and it's not 8 p.m. It's Monday at 6 p.m. Not Monday a few days from now, but Monday a week from a few days from now. So Monday the 23rd. That will cover everything through the second law. Just some side conversations I can hear, so you be quiet, please. Exam three goes through everything through the second law. The final exam will include cycles. So we're going to have a lot of cycles. Cycles is where thermodynamics really comes together to be useful for the world, and that's on the final exam. Because there's an exam that Monday, there is no class on Monday, 11/23. Because there's Thanksgiving that week, there is no class on Wednesday, 11/25. There's also no quiz on Wednesday, 11/25. So that's an easy week, except for the exam. And then you come back, we do have a full week after that. And you will have a homework due that final week of class. And as of right now, I plan on giving you a quiz. So you have a quiz today, you have a quiz next week, and then probably a quiz that final week, unless somehow I change my mind. And then you have a final exam. I don't know if they've posted final exam times yet. Somebody know?
They have.
When is it, do you know?
12th.
It's the 12th? That's not bad. Usually it's like the 18th or something like that. So the exam's on December 12th? Yeah. And we'll do that in an integrated exam with Professor Hall's class also for the final. Lots of chatter. So are there questions about this? Yes.
So it's through and including the second law.
Through and including, yes. Including.
Can we put the chapter numbers to that? Is that up to chapter 8?
Can't remember. So I'll spec that for you, so I don't have it on my brain right now. And I'll check with Hall about that. Like the second law includes a lot of the Gibbs equations and isotropic efficiencies and that kind of thing. And some of the isotropic process relations, we'll talk through some of that today. But probably won't include the Carnot cycle stuff. But I'll come back with a clear spec on that. So we don't have that many classes left. We have class today, we have class Friday, gone on Monday. We'll figure out what we'll do about Monday. And then Wednesday, then class review on Friday for the exam on Monday. That's it. We're cutting down to single digit kind of classes left for the semester. And we still have a lot to learn. All right, any other questions about the exam or anything else? All right, let's do a review of gas power cycles. And there's different gas power cycles. There are the internal combustion engines of cars, like gasoline engines and diesel engines. There's also the Brayton engine, the Brayton cycle, which is used for jet engines, things like that. And the different types of analysis. We started to introduce this last time. There's air standard analysis. And for this, you treat combustion as heat addition. And it's almost always, the combustion is almost always at constant pressure. Not always, but almost always. We talk about a constant pressure combustor where you have a burner. Like, if you think of a stovetop burner, that's a constant pressure because it's got atmospheric pressure around it. So says constant pressure combustion. Yes.
Sorry, but this is back to the bioexam. It looks like there's two bioexams for this class.
Oh, good for you. Well, you guys want to take two? No, I'm just kidding. So I think there might be confusion because there was a one that was originally assigned, and then we have an integrated one or coordinated one with Dr. Hall. So I'll confirm which one it is, but I don't think you have two times. I'm being kind of a smart ass. What are the two dates or times that are listed?
There's a Thursday one and then a Friday one.
On the 12th and 13th?
It's like you,
No, 10th and 11th.
Yeah, the 10th and 11th. One was from 7 to 10, the other was from 10 to 5.
Okay, 7 to 10, 2 to 5. Okay, we'll figure this out. I'll get back to you on that. Yeah, I don't think you get to vote. I think it's up to like the system or something. I think I have no say on it. Usually, they take the Monday, Wednesday, Friday class around this time and give it the worst possible exam time, which is like Saturday night, the last night of the exam period, or something like that.
It was supposed to be Saturday, 2 to 5.
Okay. All right. I'll look into it. I'll get back to you. And Sam and Arkansas, if you would remind me to look into that, that'd be great. All right, so for air standard analysis, internal combustion is just simple heat addition. That combustion almost always occurs at constant pressure. There is an exception for the auto cycle. This is the diesel, the gasoline engine cycle. The pressure is not constant during combustion, but the Qin, the heat addition, occurs at constant volume. So it's not a constant pressure combustion process in the auto cycle. And we'll come back to that next time. It is a constant volume combustion process. So that's air standard analysis. You also have ideal air standard analysis. And this is very similar, but this just means that your specific heats are not a function of temperature. That you've got an ideal system. It doesn't mean ideal gas, it just means you're in ideal air analysis. Your specific heats don't vary with temperature. It does not necessarily mean 100% efficiency. There are some cases where we will do analysis assuming 100% efficient turbine and 100% efficient compressor, but that's not what ideal air standard analysis means. It does not mean 100% efficiency, it just means your specific heat still vary with temperature. It's not like with monatomic gas, isn't it? Okay, we will talk about brayton cycles, auto cycles, and diesel cycles more, and I'm gonna give an example today of the brayton cycle with an afterburner. Let's start with a Brayton cycle, which we've already introduced before. The Brayton cycle, its importance, I would say it's very important. And this is for jet engines. It's also for natural gas power plants. So you probably flown in a plane with a Brayton cycle, and you're getting electricity right now from UT. There's a Brayton cycle. It's also a combined cycle with other types of cycle. And the Brayton cycle, well, I'll show you pictures in a little bit, but it's got a compressor, combustor, and a turbine. Compress the gas, burn the gas, expand the gas, and cool it through a turbine. If you have isentropic processes, which is a reasonable way to start with your analysis. If you have isentropic processes for your turbine and your compressor, you don't usually say that for your combustor, because you're adding heat, and think of heat and entropy going hand in hand. But if you have isentropic process, then for your turbine and compressor, your change entropy is zero. You can use your isentropic gas relations, T2 over T1 equals P2 over P1, K over K minus 1. I'm sorry, K minus 1 over K. Just testing to see if you guys have paid attention. So we have isentropic relationships that we developed like 2 weeks ago. that get you your isentropic temperature ratio with your isentropic pressure ratio raise the power of k minus 1 over k. And we get this relationship from Gibbs' relationship, which delta S equals Cp ln T2 over T1 minus R ln T2 over T1. And if your change entropy is zero, you can set the terms on either side of this to equal to each other, and then you can do your algebra and math to get the equations. These are useful expressions for you to write on your card, your exam, and to understand when you apply them. You don't always apply them, you apply them for isentropic processes with ideal gases. And with Cp as constant. If your specific heat is not equal to constant, all right, so this is, if you don't have constant specific heats, then you use delta S equals zero equals S2 naught minus S1 naught minus R ln P2 over P1. So you have your S naughts, which are in the tables, which you can use in the case where your specific heat is not constant, and you can calculate the changes. Someone's already calculated for you, they've tabulated them in the tables. Or you can use your P2 naught over P1 naught equals P2 over P1, or you can have your V2 naught over V1 naught equals V2 over V1. So if you do not have specific heats that are constant, then you have to use your P naught, V naught, or S naught relationships. But if your specific heat is constant, you've got a simpler ratio to use. And then in this case, you would solve for your, say, S2 naught, or P2 naught, or V2 naught, and that gets you T2 and H2. So you usually want to know what's your temperature when you're done, or what's your enthalpy when you're done. And you get there by using your S naught, P naught, V naughts, and your ratios or pressures or volumes or your S naughts along the way. But if your specific heat is constant, which sometimes you can assume is okay, like if we tell you assume it's constant, or if you think your conditions are reasonable for that, you can use the analytical expression up here. So this is all for an isentropic process. So isentropic processes with your specific heat constant, isentropic processes where your specific heat are not constant, but it's still isentropic, like your magical devices. Any questions? I've got more variation on V, but any questions on that so far? Yes? This is a V, that's constant V. So say that V equals constant. So that's in auto cycle, you have top dead center where your piston's at the top dead center of its stroke, and the combustion occurs there, it's a constant volume, and then it expands the volume, pushes
everything. What are the different efficiencies that NET?
So this is the efficiency T for the efficiency of the turbine, and the ASC or efficiency of C, the compressor.
Oh, okay.
So an ideal system doesn't mean it has 100% efficiency. It just means you can treat the system in an ideal or simplified way where the specific heat doesn't vary with temperature or specific heat is constant. Right, what if it's not isentropic? So I just showed you isentropic. Let's talk about a non-isentropic condition. If your compressor and turbine are not isentropic, then use your efficiencies. So use your efficiency for the turbine, or efficiency for the compressor. The efficiency for the turbine
equals the actual work out of the turbine over the isentropic work out of the turbine. Using A to denote actual and S to denote isentropic and T for turbine. Your efficiency, your compressor, is the isentropic work over the actual work. So the turbine gives you work out, gives you the actual work out over the perfect work out is your efficiency. The compressor takes work in, the perfect work in over the actual work in is your efficiency. So if it's isentropic, you can use relationships on the far board. If it's not isentropic, like it's a real system with a non-100% efficiency, then you need to adjust that for your isentropic case and your actual case. And your efficiency in your turbine, for a typical turbine, is HN minus H out actual over HN minus H out isentropic. So that's for a typical adiabatic turbine. Looking at the change in entropy, change in enthalpy across the turbine is the work you get out of it. You come in with high enthalpy, you leave with low enthalpy, and that high enthalpy, as it converts to low enthalpy, spits work out. And your efficiency of your compressor is your H out S minus H in, or H out actual minus H in. And that's for an adiabatic compressor. Pay attention to where the isentropic and the actual one is, numerator, denominator, whether it's H out minus H in or H in minus H out. And that will become natural to you as you understand the devices. You are putting work in to a compressor, you're taking low enthalpy stuff, adding work which comes out as higher enthalpy later on. And so it leaves with more enthalpy that it starts with because you added energy through the work. And the isentropic, the ideal case is on the numerator for the compressor, other way around, the turbine, both in where the high enthalpy is coming around and what's on the denominator. Yeah.
Does this end up in the initial conditions and
we get the initial conditions? Yeah, so typically you'll know the initial conditions in this case. You know what's coming in and you know what kind of work you want out of it or what you put into it. You want to know what's the exit. That's for adiabatic, and it's just an energy balance. You end up getting here through an energy balance. The work equals, so you have energy in equals energy out, these are steady flow, steady state devices. Your energy in is, for the compressor, the enthalpy in and the work in, the energy out is just the enthalpy out, because there's no Q for these adiabatic systems. So assume isentropic to get H out S. So this is where the isentropic ratios become really important. Even for a real device that's not isentropic, you might know the efficiency, and then you can still do isentropic analysis to get your H out S, your perfect conditions. And then use efficiency to get your H out actual, or use your H out actual to get your efficiency. Writing down some of these relationships and really understanding when you can use them is important. Because it's easy to write down an equation and then write it down in your exam, but you're applying it in the wrong case. Like maybe it's not an adiabatic turbine on the exam. And then you're using an adiabatic expression to get it wrong. So don't just write down the relationships, write down when and how to use them. All right, so we can improve the Brayton cycle also. And that's what we'll work through today. Improve the Brayton cycle with reheat. You can do it with intercooling. And you can do it with a regenerator. Reheat can be with an afterburner, which we're about to work. So the different ways you can improve the brain cycle. And people do that in real life. You might have many stages to do intercooling in between. You might have reheat to get more entropy into the system. And by the way, I left something out. You have a back work ratio. We talked about this last time, I think. Back work ratio of UWR equals the work of the compressor of the work of the turbine. And for a typical setup, that's H2 minus H1 over H3 minus H4 for a typical braking cycle where you have four steps around it. You have work around the turbine. Some fraction of the work just drives the compressor. It should have excess work that drives your electricity generator or gives you thrust on the pump. But some fraction of the work from the turbine is just to drive the compressor. Any questions on that before we start walking through your homework? Alright. This is your homework. These are a different set of problems than what's in the app. It says at the very top, don't miss this, prepare a TS diagram and a state table for each problem. Andrew Reimer has went through a state table with you last time, so you've seen what a state table looks like as you walk through the cycle. First problem, a gas turbine power plant operates with an 8-to-1 pressure ratio, which means the compressor is raising the pressure by a factor of 8 from inlet to outlet. With inlet conditions at 20 degrees Celsius in an atmosphere, the combustor provides 0.2 megajoules per second, producing a turbine inlet temperature of 1,000 degrees Celsius. That's kind of a typical combustion temperature. Assume both compressor and turbine have efficiency of 90%, so these are not perfect systems, but they're pretty good. And do not assume constant specific heats. That's a good clue to notice. This is that probably means you're looking stuff up in the tables, that kind of thing. What is the airflow rate, both kilograms per second and cubic meters per second, the inlet? And what's the net power output cycle efficiency, a percentage of the turbo work used by the compressor, which is the back work ratio, which I just defined for you here. This is the break cycle. Compressor, combustor, turbine. Those steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, are appropriate numbering for this back work ratio. Take your air in, atmospheric conditions, atmospheric temperature pressure, you squeeze it or compress it to 8 times the pressure, you heat it with a combustor where you burn fuel to get heat, and it comes out at a higher temperature, and then you have that high temperature, high pressure gas that wants to expand in the turbine. As it does so, it gives you rotational work in the shaft, and then you can get electricity or something else out of it. Problem 9-7, this is the problem we're going to work in class in just a second, so I'll read it to you now and we'll come back to it. An ideal turbojet with afterburner operates at altitudes where the ambient pressure is 10 kilopascals, so the air is light up there. It's very thin. The air temperature is minus 20 degrees Celsius. It's cool. The pressure ratio is 7.5-to-1. These are typical ratios. The maximum turbine temperature allowable is 1,500 degrees Celsius. And the airflow rate is 8.2 kilograms per second. What is the exit velocity without an afterburner? And what is the rate of heat input? The Q dot to the combustor, CV. And if you turn on the afterburner, it doubles your fuel consumption, which is a lot, but it gives you a higher exit velocity. What is that exit velocity with the afterburner on? And so this is a Brayton cycle, but then we've added steps 5 and 6 because there's an afterburner, AB, and then the nozzle. And there's more heat, Q dot AB there as well. Assume ideal aerostator conditions with constant specific heats evaluated at the mean temperature of the cycle. All right, we do constant specific heats, but at the middle temperature of the whole cycle. We'll come back to the work that problem. Problem 917, an engine operating on an auto cycle has pressure and temperature at the beginning of the isentropic compression. Ooh, isentropic compression at 0.12 megapascals and 35 degrees Celsius respectively. If the peak pressure and peak temperature of the cycle are 4.8 megapascals and 2500 degrees Celsius, determine the compression ratio, the net work done per cycle, and the cycle efficiency using hot air standard assumptions. And hot air standard assumptions means you assume constant specific heats evaluated at the initial temperature of each process step. So each step has a constant specific heat, but at the temperature of the inlet conditions for that step. Then you have an air standard diesel cycle engine operates as follows. Beginning the compression stroke, the temperature and pressure are 30 degrees Celsius and 0.1 megapascals, which is a hot day outside. And the temperature and pressure at the end of the combustion process are 1650 degrees Celsius and 4.5 megapascals. So really high compression ratios. Assuming temperature dependence, specific heats. These are all very important clues. Determine the compression ratio, cutoff ratio, heat transfer input, network per cycle and cycle efficiency, that kind of thing. And we'll talk about the cutoff, what that is in the next lecture. And then there's some isentropic process relationships for ideal gases. These are isentropic relationships for ideal gases. Don't use them with liquids and don't use them with non-isentropic processes. But this is where your P-naughts ratios equal to your pressure ratios, your V-naughts are equal to your volume ratios. And you can look up those values. And then a couple relationships down at the bottom. Relating to your T2s and your T2 over T1 to P2 over P1 and that kind of thing. And these were all derived before, but just conveniently summarized for you here. So this is your homework due next week. Let's solve problem 9-7. Hopefully I can get through it. I'm not sure I can get all the way through it. So, problem 9-7. This is an ideal turbojet with afterburner. And we have a compressor with a turbine. We have a combustor. You have air coming into the compressor on the left, gets compressed to a higher state, starts off state one, a higher pressure state, state two, goes through the combustor, state three, and then it has Q dot in for the combustor. It's at high enthalpy, high pressure, high temperature gases that expand from the turbine, and that goes to the afterburner that then comes out and goes through a nozzle. So you have six stages through here, six states, or six locations in the system. Oh, by the way, there's heat in the afterburner. And we know some things along the way. We know that temperature one equals minus 20 degrees Celsius, which equals 253 Kelvin. And we know that the pressure coming in is 10 kilopascals. And we know that T3 equals 1500 degrees Celsius. And that is equal to 1773 Kelvin. And we know that the rate of work into the combustor equals the rate of work out of the turbine, in this case. Because it's not making electrical power, it's giving us thrust. So any shaft work coming out will go straight to the compressor. And we're given a few other things. Given that it's got a ratio of pressures equals 7.5 to 1, and that means P2 equals 7.5 P1, and that equals 75 kilopascals. We know the mass flow rate is 8.2 kilograms per second, and we know that the Q dot in at the combustor equals a Q dot in at the afterburner. Because of the problem spec, it says you can double your heat input at the afterburner. So those are given. We can make some assumptions. Uh,
air is an ideal gas. Cp equals constant at the mean temperature for the cycle. Negligible changes to kinetic and potential energy, except at the nozzle. It says steady flow, steady state. And then we have this case where it's an ideal system, an ideal turbojet. We're not going to compare efficiencies. You know, and compressor efficiency equals turbine efficiency equals a nozzle efficiency equals 100%. So we said earlier that an ideal air standard analysis doesn't mean that the device is 100% efficiency, because ideal air standard analysis is talking about the air. But we're now talking about an ideal turbojet, and so now the devices we're treating as ideal. So you have to be clear to understand, are we talking about how we're treating the properties of the air, or how we're treating the properties of the devices? If the devices are ideal, then they'll have 100% efficiency. But if the air is ideal, that doesn't mean your devices have 100% efficiency. Let's assume that the compressor, the turbine, and the nozzle are adiabatic. We have no reason to think otherwise. And it's reasonable to think for a combustor that P3 equals P2, P6 equals P1. It's exiting the nozzle back to the inlet conditions. And P5 equals P4. Typically, your combustors are constant pressure, unless it's an internal combustion engine, you might think twice about that. But for these flow-through combustors, like with a Brayton cycle, constant pressure is a reasonable assumption for the combustor and the afterburner. And then the gases exit the nozzle back to the atmospheric conditions. Well, those conditions are the same as the inlet, so the pressure is the same. A lot of assumptions, a lot of givens. We're going to find some things. You know what, I'm going to run out of room. Try to be more compact over here. What do we want to find? That's where I'm going to squeeze in over here. Find part A, you want to find the velocity is 6 without the afterburner. You want to find the heat rate in to the combustor. And you want to find velocity 6 with the afterburner. How much fuel does it take to run this thing, and how much faster would it go if you added more fuel? Okay, before I solve this, any questions about the setup or the assumptions or anything in the problem statement? Yes?
Why is the pressure at 6 equal to the pressure at 1?
These are atmospheric conditions at the end of the nozzle.
Okay.
And atmospheric conditions are going to change over the length of the point. So it might not be immediately behind the nozzle, it might still be hot, but you go back enough, it'll be atmospheric again. Good question. Any other questions? All right, let's do some general equations. You do your first law for steady flow, steady state. What does that mean? E dot in equals E dot out. The rate at which energy comes in equals the rate at which energy goes out. There's no energy accumulated. Second law. Your change entropy that you accumulate over time equals heat transfer over the temperature at which it occurs, plus your M dot S in minus S out, plus your entropy rate of generation. Then you have another relationship, Gibbs, which says your change entropy equals CPLN T2 over T1 minus RLN T2 over T1. So you have a variety of relationships you can use for this. All right, let's start by looking at the system without the afterburner, because that's the first part, is what's the velocity at the end of the nozzle without the afterburner? Okay, so this is without afterburner. And generally for these cycles, if you can, you start in your inlet conditions and you work your way through. So let's start with the compressor. At the compressor, we know some information. We know this isentropic. And we can use constant set of heats, T2 over T1 equals P2 over P1 to the K minus 1 over K. We have an isentropic relation. We know the pressure ratio, we don't know the temperature. So we know P2 over P1, we'd like to find T2. So T2 equals T1 times P2 over P1, K minus 1 over K. Well, that's easy. But what's K? Need to find K. And K equals Cp over Cv. What's Cp? Depends on temperature, but we're told to do it with ideal air standard conditions with constant specific heat at the mean temperature of the cycle. So we need to find the mean temperature of the cycle. Cp equals Cp at temperature of the mean. And that temperature of the mean is somewhere between, it's like 700, goes from minus 20 degrees Celsius to 1500, so 760 degrees Celsius. And you do the same thing for Cv, and then you can look back from the table. Table 5S. And K is around
1.335.
760, 740. Oh, okay. So 740. Yeah. Sorry. Yes, 1500 minus 20. You could look up, you could do some interpolation, look up the values in the table to find what your K is. And then you plug in your K, and you get T2 equals about 419.7 Kelvin. That's just for the compressor. We know the pressure ratio, we know it's isentropic. We know it's ideal gas. We can use the isentropic ideal gas relationships for constant specific heat at the mean temperature. So we gotta find Cp, find Cv, then we get K, we use a relationship, then we get T2. We did all that just to find that one parameter, T2. Then we can analyze the work needed in the compressor. The rate of work into the compressor equals the mass flow rate times H2 minus H1. Ideal gas, you do m dot Cp times T2 minus T1. We know the temperature difference, we know Cp, we just found it. So we know the rate of the work in is 1563 kilojoules per second. So we did the analysis of the compressor to find out, we know the inlet conditions, what the outlet conditions are. If we know the outlet conditions, we know what kind of work was put into it, because the outlet conditions have higher energy, that energy must have come from somewhere. Where did it come from? It came from the work we put in. So that's compressor analysis. Now let's do the turbine analysis. I'll stop there. Hang on a second. Any questions on the compressor before I go into the turbine? Yes?
How did you know it was isentropic?
Couple things. We're told it's an ideal system. And so if you have ideal turbojet, the turbine's compressors are likely isentropic. The combustor isn't necessarily. but the compressors and turbines are. We talked about this just earlier in this class, or at the very start of this class, whether okay if it's a typical air standard analysis, an ideal air standard analysis, that you have isotropic processes, not necessarily 100% efficient, but isotropic for your turbines and compressors. All right, so if we look at the turbine, we do a first law analysis. The rate of work out of the turbine equals m dot h3 minus h4. Go prove yourself that's true, but you have energy coming in, energy going out, and the enthalpy is much lower leaving than coming in. Where did the energy go? It went to the work out. And that's equal to m dot Cp T3 minus T4. And in this case, your work out of your turbine equals your work in of your compressor. That's not true for a power plant, but it is true for a plane. And so you can correlate or connect these different things. You have m dot Cp T3 minus T4 equals m dot Cp T2 minus T1. You're probably seeing what I see, which is you can scratch out some of these terms, and you have a difference in temperature. In this case, the turbine equals a difference in temperature for the compressor, which I think is sort of interesting. And then you can find T4 equals 1609 Kelvin. I know I'm going quickly, we've only got a few minutes. For an isentropic turbine, you can use your temperature ratios. T4 over T3 equals P4 over P3 over K minus 1 over K. And that gives you P4. P4 equals P3, T4 over T3 to the K over K minus 1. And P4 equals 51.0 kilopascals. So it didn't quite drop all the way down to atmospheric pressure yet, so a little higher. So we're just stepping through device by device for this analysis and do an energy balance on each one. And you have a nozzle. And for the nozzle, you have enthalpy coming in equals the enthalpy coming going out plus the velocity going out. Now there's no afterburner in this case. This is all without afterburner. So the afterburner is off. That means the conditions leaving the turbine are the same as the conditions coming into the nozzle. Isentropic. So you have T6 over T4 equals P6 over P4 over to the K minus 1 over K. So you're using, for isentropic processes, keep using these isentropic relationships. And it gives you T6 equals 1069 Kelvin. And velocity 6 equals over 1,000 meters per second. It's pretty fast. Go back, figure out what the combustor required for heat input. The combustor, Q dot N, the heat going in the combustor, is equal to the change in enthalpies across the combustor. And it gives you Q dot N equals 12.7 megajoules per second. So just marching through one device at a time and looking at the changes in energy across the device tells you what the energy in or out is based on that for a steady flow, steady state series of devices. All right, now let's do it with the afterburner. And with the afterburner,
Everything up to 4 is the same. Up to state 4. Because the afterburner occurs after state 4. So it's all the same stuff up to there, but we're going to add more heat or add more fuel. For the afterburner, you do an energy balance. Your Q dot in for the afterburner equals your mass flow rate times H5 minus H4 equals M dot CP T5 minus T4. And by the way, we know what the Q is because by problem definition, that Q is equal to the Q of the combustor, so it's 12.7 megajoules per second. And then we can find T5 equals 2963.6 Kelvin. Do the energy balance plus the problem statement to find out what it is. But the pressure is the same, so we assume the pressure is the same. P5 equals P4. Go to the nozzle. Same kind of energy balance. We're starting off with a different ratio. It's T6 to T5. Over there, I did it T6 to T4. Equals P6 over P5, K minus 1 over K. Then you got a higher temperature ratio this time. And then you end up getting a velocity of 1508.7 meters per second. You can really juice this thing up where you double the fuel and your velocity goes up by 40%. Pretty good, but you might think that's expensive because fuel is not cheap. If you draw this on a TS diagram, 30 more seconds, I'll let you go. Draw this on a TS diagram if you're required to for the homework. You have a Brayton cycle, TS diagram. You're going through the compressor from 1 to 2. Then you have constant pressure heating from 2 to 3. Then you come down to 4. That's what you would normally do for a Brayton cycle. But we're going to stop it partway through. And we're going to add some more heat all the way down to here. So a normal Brayton cycle is here. And the afterburner part of it is there. So you get a little more oomph out of the system, so to speak, by putting more energy in there. I've kept you long, so you gotta go. That's the process you need to go through for each of these problems. Same thing, state your assumptions, draw it, what's given, go through step by step, use the appropriate relations when you can, pay attention to what you can do with the specific heat. All right, we'll see you Friday. Yeah.